Hi, I'm Cy Kellett, host of Catholic Answers Live. At Catholic Answers, we work each day to try to communicate the Catholic faith in a way that's understandable to believers and non-believers alike. Today, we've got some of the best recent questions and answers from our daily radio show to share with you. Addressing caller questions will be our own apologists, Tim Staples and Jimmy Akin, and our special guests, Brandon Vogt, Dr. Carrie Gress, and Rose Sweet. Questions on today's show include, how can I explain that Catholicism is not just jumping through hoops to get to heaven? If someone came up to you and asked, why are you a Christian, what would you say? How is Mary a perfect model for the modern woman? Is every seemingly insignificant item or fact in the Bible without error? And much more. Thanks for joining us. Enjoy the show.
I am calling. My husband and I are actually starting RCIA tomorrow. We're really excited about it, and a large part of that is due to this program, so thanks so much.
But, no, thank you. Thanks for sharing with us. That's beautiful news.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you. We're really looking forward to it. My question is concerning sharing with both of our Protestant families kind of this process that we're about to start. And one piece of feedback, I guess, that I received from my mother-in-law was that she feels like Catholicism makes it difficult to find God. Her wording was that she feels like it's jumping through hoops to access God. So I guess my question is, how can I explain with grace that that is not how it is without really being super knowledgeable yet all about Catholicism, since I haven't gone through that process yet?
Oh, yeah, Liz, it's a great question. Having been raised Protestant myself, I can really empathize with that situation, because that's exactly what I believed. When you're raised with a false gospel, which is in essence what Protestantism has been proclaiming for 500 years, is a false gospel in this sense, this gospel that says that we don't have to do anything in order to get to heaven, right? We don't have to do anything, you know, and then there's that sort of all we have to do is accept Jesus, right? We don't have to do anything. All we have to do is accept Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior. Of course, there's an inherent contradiction there. But, you know, the point that I like to make to folks when they say that is, what if Jesus Christ himself said, all right, you complain that we Catholics say you have to jump through hoops. Well, what if Jesus Christ came down to this earth and said, you have to jump through hoops in order to get to heaven? Wouldn't you jump through hoops, right? I mean, it's a way, rhetorically, you know, to get folks thinking. And then, you know, you can present scriptures like for example, John 3:16. We all know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And we can say, look, Jesus tells us there's something we have to do. Believe. And do you believe? Now, if somebody's a strict Lutheran that adheres to Luther's idea that faith is something that we don't do, this is something that's merely passively received, well, then we'll have to deal with that. But most Protestants today will acknowledge, unless they're hardcore monergism, you know, Calvinists that say it's God acting through us. And so, then that's a whole nother question. You know, then you have to talk about the fact is we do have to believe. I mean, Jesus in many, many places, Liz, tells us, and one of my favorites is John chapter 10, verse 30 through 35, where Jesus, you know, declares himself to be God. He says, I and the Father are one, in John chapter 10, verse 30. And, of course, in verse 31, they pick up rocks to kill him, which is kind of predictable. You call yourself God in ancient Israel, they're going to pick up rocks, and they did. But Jesus, if you skip down a few verses there, 34, 35, you see, Jesus says this. He says, if you can't believe my words, believe for the work's sake. So Jesus knew they were going to struggle with this idea of him being God, right? But he's saying that belief is something you have to do. Look, if you can't believe my words, believe for the sake of the works. Do you get that, Liz, how Jesus says to us, belief is not just something we receive, it's also something we have to do. We acknowledge Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that of your not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. The initial grace of salvation that Paul's talking about there, faith itself, is a gift. We can't work our way to the gift of faith. We can't. It is a gift. But once we receive the gift, we have to act on it. We have to believe. And that's what Jesus is saying there. So, Liz, what I try to do is show them, look, Jesus tells us in John 3:16 that we have to believe. It's not just a pure passively received gift, but it's something we have to do. And then you show them Revelation 2:10. Not only do we have to believe, that is, have faith, but Revelation 2:10, Jesus says, if we are faithful unto death, he will give us the crown of life. Notice that. He says, be faithful. In other words, faith is not something you just receive, not something just that you do, but you have to be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. So, Liz, this is what I do. I show folks that belief, faith is a gift. It's also something we have to do, and it's something we have to continue to do. We have to be faithful unto death. And then you show them verses like Matthew 10:22. Jesus says, you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endures until the end shall be saved. You show them Mark 16:16. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. There are so many clear verses like that to tell us, guess what? Yeah, we got to jump through a few hoops. But once you see it, at least for me, Liz, when I started as a Protestant to see, look, this isn't jumping through hoops. This isn't, you know, the negative connotation that I was raised with. If you have to do anything, oh, that's denying Jesus. It's Jesus that tells me I have to be baptized, I have to be faithful, I have to endure till the end.
Yeah, so I've been a Catholic all my life, and I'm struggling with my faith and believing in God. I believe that he has a love, like, personally for me, and I've actually been to seminary. I was a seminarian, and I this question has been in my mind, just why am I a Christian? And I wanted to ask, like, you, Brandon, like, you know, if someone in the show's topic about sharing your faith, if someone were to come up to you and say, Brandon, why are you Christian? You know, what would you say to that? And I, you know, that would be, you know, compelling. And And because I'm asking myself that, and I'm like, well, I don't know why I'm Christian, you know, and maybe I do have reasons, but I'm like, you know, it's almost not convincing, I guess, enough to me. And so I just wanted to know your answer.
Yeah, thanks so much for that, Michael, and thanks for your vulnerability. First of all, let me just affirm that Jesus does love you. God loves you. I think the clearest affirmation of that is what he did on the cross for you. You know, it was Augustine who said that Christ died for all of us as if we were the only one here. He would have died for you, even if you were the only one. So God loves you. So don't forget that. I think if somebody asked me, why are you Christian? I'd give the same answer that G.K. Chesterton gave to the question, why are you Catholic? He said, ultimately, there are thousands of reasons that amount to one reason, because it's true. And that's what I'd say if somebody asked me, why are you a Christian? Well, because Christianity is true. And what would I do to defend that? Well, I would make two cases. First, that God exists. I think we have very good reasons to believe that God exists. Second, I think we have very good reasons to believe that Jesus is God. And if those two things are true, then Christianity is true. Christianity, unlike any other religion, believes that Jesus is not just a good man, not just a wise teacher, but is God. He's divine. And so if we can prove those two things, then we got good reason to think Christianity is true. Now, there are lots of lines of evidence to support each of those two statements. We've talked about the first one a little bit so far, atheism. How do you show that God is real, that God exists? And I mentioned a few good resources to help with that already. Trent Horn's book, Answering Atheism, does a great job. Catholic Answers has a nice little booklet called 20 Answers God to help show you the good reasons why God exists. But then the question of Jesus, which is more central to this why Christianity question, focus on the resurrection, the resurrection, the resurrection. As Paul says, if the resurrection is false, our faith is in vain. So everything hinges on whether Jesus really rose from the dead. And again, I think we got strong reasons to believe that the resurrection is a historical fact. One good book on that is called The Case for the Resurrection. It's by Gary Habermas. He's a Protestant scholar, but he makes, I think, an airtight case that the resurrection best explains the historical facts that we know about Jesus's last days on earth. And so check out that book. But what you want to do is realize the truth of Christianity. It doesn't hinge on how I feel about it. Some days I feel it might be true. Some days I'm having, you know, emotional worries and doubts. Lock yourself into the truth of it and read apologetical books, read good arguments for Christianity. That'll strengthen your faith and squeeze out the doubts. So that's probably what I'd recommend.
You know, the image of womanhood that Mary gives us, if we say, well, that's a woman who lived fully what God intended for womanhood, as we may look at Jesus and say that's a perfect model for manhood and womanhood too as well. But so if we look at her, then we say that about her, many, many people will say to us, are you kidding me? Like, where was her career? And she was a shrinking violet. And what are you talking about? That's such an old-fashioned view of women.
Mm-hmm. No, I think that's one of the real tragedies today. It's almost laughable. I mean, we're sitting here laughing about it. Just this connection between, I mean, there is no connection. There's this chasm, really, between what women are today and what we think women are supposed to be versus what Our Lady was and the model that she offers us. And so I think this is, like I said, one of the clues that we have that this is why Mary is such an incredible advocate for us at this stage, because Satan knows that if we can erase the image of Mary from the family, from the minds of men, then they're going to be sort of left stranded, because women have a particular role to help bring men to holiness in a very unique way. And it's because we are made to be like Mary. I mean, it's no accident that all the women at the foot of the cross are named Mary. So it's these kinds of hints and tips or insights that we have that we can see that she's an important piece for this time in our culture. But trying to bring those pieces back together is incredibly challenging, because we have so really silenced women who aren't a part of what I've been calling the matriarchy, which I think is really the predominant voice that we have in the world today that's sort of dictating the way women should think. You know, everything from women are always victims, you know, men and masculinity need to be wiped out. Gender neutrality is great, and you can be as fluid as you want, unless, of course, that means you're going back to being a heterosexual. All of these kinds of issues are being dictated to us. And so, and anything that opposes that, really, you get attacked as just suggesting that women should just be doormats. And of course, you know, no one's suggesting that. And I think this is one of the things that as Catholic women we have to do is really try and help other women understand that there's a lot more to being a woman than what the matriarch is presenting, but also try and connect the dots between what it means to be a feminine woman and what it means to follow Mary. And that's a tall order, I think, at this stage. And this is, again, where the rosary and just looking at asking for Our Lady's help and the guidance of the Holy Spirit can really be helpful.
A caller asks, is every seemingly insignificant item or fact in the Bible without error? And if so, can Acts 15 be explained?
The way the church understands the inspiration of Scripture, everything, this is, you can read about this in a Second Vatican Council document called Dei Verbum. It's the dogmatic constitution on divine revelation. And according to Dei Verbum, everything that the sacred authors assert is also asserted by the Holy Spirit. And so therefore, if the Holy Spirit asserts something, it's true. It doesn't matter whether it's a big matter or a small matter. If the Holy Spirit asserts something, it's true. And so the key is to identify what is being asserted in Scripture. Now, that's a more complex issue than you might think. A lot of people have a tendency to just want to take any sentence out of Scripture and say, well, this is making an assertion, and so this has to be literally true. Well, that's not the case. For example, the New Testament quotes the devil. Well, okay, so if you can't just take a sentence that's attributed to the devil and say, ah, this is an assertion in Scripture, it must be true. Okay, no, what's being asserted in Scripture is that this represents something the devil said. That doesn't mean you can trust what the devil said.
Okay, so scripture is not vouching for the accuracy of things said by the devil. It may be asserting the devil said this, but that's not saying the devil's right. So that's an obvious example. There are others. In the, oftentimes you'll encounter things that are symbolic, like in the writings of the prophets. Well, being a symbol, it's not literally true. It expresses a truth, but it expresses truth in a symbolic form. And that's true not only in the writings of the prophets, it's also true in the poetic writings, because poetry uses symbols, like the book of Psalms. Or it's like when the psalmist says, I will awaken the dawn. Well, he means he's going to stay up all night praising God, or at least stay up late praising God. He doesn't mean the sun can literally be woken up and shaken out of bed. That's a poetic expression. Similarly, in the parables of Jesus, they when he says there was this guy with two sons, he doesn't mean it literally. This is an imaginary story that teaches a truth, and it's the truth that's being asserted. It would be the wrong question to say, ooh, what were the names of the sons and what were their birthdays?
That's not
really what's happening here. So we have to be careful about taking a statement and figuring out what's really being asserted. It's not always obvious, and you can't just grab a sentence and say, well, this is some fundamental literal statement of truth. And in a way, that's what's the generating your second question, Joe, about the Council of Acts, because it does, in the Council of the proceedings of the Council of Acts 15, contain a prohibition on Gentiles consuming blood. And as you correctly note, that's something that is undermined by Jesus's declaration of all foods being clean, as well as the historic practice of the church. But if you look more closely at the text of Acts 15, you'll see the reason these things are proposed is they're proposed not as matters of fundamental theological truth, but they're proposed, James says, because Moses has been preached in every city, and so to keep the peace between Jews and Gentiles, the council is willing, even though it's not willing to ask Gentiles to be circumcised, it is willing to ask them to defer to Jewish sensibilities on certain questions, not because they have to for theological reasons, but because Moses has been preached in all these cities and it's going to scandalize Jews if they are aware of Gentile Christians drinking blood. So please refrain from drinking blood for the sake of church peace. And that understanding of this matter is applied in St. Paul's writings. If you look in Romans 14 and 1 Corinthians 8, where he talks about the same essential principle being applied to food that's been offered to idols. He's saying there's nothing wrong with it in principle, but for the sake of church unity, you don't want to scandalize anybody. And that's essentially what's happening with the same requirements we find in Acts 15 concerning the consumption of blood or things strangled or things offered to idols, which are also mentioned there. So in that case, what's being asserted is that the Council of Acts recommended this practice as a practical matter for keeping church peace, but it's not being asserted that we must never eat blood.
When I hear you speak the way you're speaking about God's intention for us to be happy and to enjoy the goods of this world and to enjoy them in an integrated way so that we're still looking forward to the goods of the next world primarily, how does any of that match up with Jesus saying, take up your cross each day and follow me?
Oh, good question.
Really? I had one.
So, so let's talk about the four basic levels of happiness. And the first level is things in the created world, the food, clothing, shelter, cars, games, toys, anything that, even a beautiful sunset and music, things outside ourselves make us happy. When we enjoy them, we master them, we like them, right? But the next highest level of happiness is ego satisfaction. It has to do with the self. Now, if I like beautiful music, but now I learn to play it myself and I master an instrument, I'm even happier when I can create, you know? And so there's ego involved in the second level of happiness. The third level of happiness is other people, okay? So now let's say I always wanted that violin. Level number one, I get the violin. Number two, I'm even happier because now I learn to play it. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Okay.
The highest, next highest level of happiness is I play for free at a concert where I could have got a $10,000 fee for orphans to do some greater good. I sacrifice. Oh, even though I could really use the money, or I even give away that violin to somebody who has none. So I even go higher in happiness. There's a richer, deeper happiness. When it's for other people, it always involves sacrifice. It's giving up my happiness and the things that I own, I possess, or I control for the greater good of another. And the more it hurts me, not to be codependent or a victim, but I freely choose to carry that cross so that somebody else can live, or somebody else can have pleasure or joy, mm-hmm. or safety.
Mm-hmm.
That's a happiness nobody can take away from you. But that only usually comes through the carrying of the cross. And it's Jesus who shows us these steps, higher steps to happiness. The highest level of happiness is union with God. So we start with things, then self, then others, but ultimately, union and holy communion forever with God is what we all desire.
Yeah.
It's what we're all made for. We can taste a little bit of that here on this earth, but we will completely in heaven.
I'm in a comedy studies program in uh-huh. Chicago.
Uh-huh.
And I was thinking about, because I'm in a comedy theory class, so I'm thinking about the relation between comedy and religion. And I noticed that in the Bible, there's a lot of talk of joy and, you know, but not a whole lot on laughter. But I'm wondering what the church's stand is on comedians and their kind of dedication to crafting mm-hmm. humor and kind of dedicating themselves to crafting essentially joy for people, and also what the ceiling is to that humor. Because it seems like everybody's got a different ceiling to what they will laugh at versus be offended by.
Uh-huh. Okay. Well, the church's position is that comedians, like actors in general, are participating in the devil's playhouse. And so this is among the works of iniquity, and you need to go to confession as quickly as possible and find a different avocation. You need to use your life in the service of God.
You should probably be a nun, don't you think? You know. Okay, Sophie, thanks for calling.
Right on that.
Hope you'll call back sometime.
Running out the door right now.
Okay, so let's back up and give a more serious answer. Humor is a fundamental part of human experience, and even though it's never mentioned that Jesus himself laughed, it is mentioned that he rejoiced, and laughter is one of the ways that we manifest rejoicing. It is something that's just a fundamental part of human nature, and this came home to me a number of years ago because I was friends with a family that included a girl who was deaf from birth, so she had never had the experience of hearing laughter. I mean, never. But I remember her being 5 years old and running around screaming and laughing with joy at the play that she and her brothers and sisters were doing. And so this is a child who had never even heard laughter. I mean, you could say, well, maybe she would mime it based on seeing it. But no, she wasn't miming it. She was laughing. And that showed me just how integrated laughter is to human nature. And so even though laughter is not mentioned a lot in Scripture, actually there is a good bit of comedy in Scripture. Jesus is known, for example, for using irony. This is one of the things, and irony is a form of comedy. And he'll even do so using sarcasm being another form of comedy. When Jesus calls people blind guides, that's ironic. That's comedy. It's not necessarily the kind of comedy that's meant to provoke laughter, but it is the kind of comedy that is meant to provoke a recognition of the contrast that is present in the concept of someone guiding others but nevertheless being blind. And that's something that's fundamental to all comedy. All comedy rests on a kind of conflict conceptually, on one level or another. There's always some kind of conflict in comedy, and that's rooted in what comedy actually is. Comedy is a form of play. We actually see parallels to comedy in other species related to us, including, for example, apes, among our closest relations in the creatures of this world. Apes have a kind of play they engage in where they have a kind of panting behavior that resembles human laughter. And we also see other animals. We see puppies and kittens playing. And one of the things that you realize if you think about play, and I've talked about this in other circumstances, is that play is a form of simulation. It prepares us for experiences that we may have later in life that we'll need to know how to handle ourselves in. So that's why puppies and kittens will play fight. And they're enjoying themselves. They need to enjoy themselves in order to engage in this behavior. So that's the incentive for them, is they are incentivized by the fun they're going to have to play fight as a way of learning how to handle themselves in a real fight. And in the same way, that's why children, like little boys, play cowboys and Indians or cops and robbers or red team versus blue team or whatever it happens to be these days. It's, again, a form of fun, safe simulation for something we're going to encounter later on in life where we may need to know how to handle ourselves in a real fight. And in the same way, comedy is a form of play that prepares us for conflict in other ways. All comedy involves some kind of conflict, usually on a conceptual level, although there also is physical comedy. But we need to know how to handle ourselves in conflict situations, and comedy is a safe, enjoyable way of learning that, of simulating that, and being ready for that later on in life.
Thanks for watching Catholic Answers Live. Join us each weekday for our live radio broadcast or check out our website at catholic.com. You can find us on YouTube at youtube.com/catholiccom or on Facebook simply by searching Catholic Answers. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations, and we'll see you next time on Catholic Answers Live.